My name is Shantaria Charleston, and I will be the host and moderator for today's call. If you've not already done so, please ensure that you have access to both the audio and video portion of the webinar. To access the PowerPoint for today's call, please follow the link on your meeting confirmation email. Right now, all participants are not in listen-only mode, which is a little bit different from what we normally do. I will ask that you please mute your lines locally so that we can avoid the feedback as the presenters speak today. However, we are really interested in your questions as well as your feedback. So to submit a comment or a question, please use the chat box that will appear on the lower right-hand side of your screen. We will make an attempt to answer as many questions as time permits at the end of today's presentation. Today's webinar is being recorded. Both the recording and the PowerPoint will be available on HAC's website, www.ruralhome.org, in the next few hours. There are just a few of us on the call today, but want to briefly give you some information about the Housing Assistance Council. We are a national nonprofit organization based in Washington, D.C. that seeks to strengthen rural communities across America through investment and assistance with affordable housing and community and economic development activities that advance rural prosperity. With the mission to improve housing conditions for the rural poor, HAC places an emphasis on striving to serve the poorest of the poor in the most rural places. So if you're interested in learning a little bit more about HAC services or products, or if you have questions or require assistance, please contact us directly. Our local as well as our national office contact information is currently being displayed on the screen. Again, thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Colonias Investment Areas, Arizona. I would like to welcome and introduce our speakers for today, Kelly Coffey, Sam Lipschitz, Lance George, and Keith Wiley. First, I will introduce Kelly Coffey. She is the Product Manager for Duty to Serve Initiatives in Rural Housing. Kelly is responsible for the management and strategic development of Fannie Mae's Single Family Rural Housing Initiative, as well as the leadership and execution of its underserved market plans under the Duty to Serve Final Rule. Her work includes serving rural markets, underserved populations, and housing innovations. Our next speaker for today is Lance George. Lance leads research and policy analysis here at the Housing Assistance Council, which encompasses a wide array of issues and topics related to affordable housing, including manufactured housing, poverty in high-needs rural areas, rural definitions and classifications, mortgage access and finance, and general demography, mapping, and data analysis of rural people and their housing conditions. Our next speaker for today is Sam Lipschitz. He's the Product Development Manager, Multifamily Affordable Initiatives with Fannie Mae. Sam manages the strategy and execution of various affordable housing initiatives in the multifamily rental space, especially projects focused on serving the needs of rural communities. Sam's work also includes strategies for addressing the challenges in workforce housing, the preservation of existing affordable rental housing, and support for environmental sustainability. Our final presenter for today is Keith Wiley. He is the Senior Research Associate at the Housing Assistance Council. His areas of interest include rural housing development, smart growth planning and policies, and environmental economics. In researching these fields, Keith has worked extensively with many data sets, HMDA, ACS, census data, et cetera, in an effort to better understand where, when, and how development patterns occur. And so with those introductions complete, I would like to turn it over to Lance George.
Thank you, Shantaria, and thank you for joining us today. Hopefully we can have some comments. I think we're having a few technical difficulties, but here's some comments from Kelly Coffey at Fannie Mae. But I'd just like to really thank you all for joining us today. We look forward to this opportunity to kind of present this concept and some of the work we're doing around this particular issue, and you're invaluable to that cause, quite frankly. We're sitting here in Washington, D.C. behind some keyboards, and you're working in communities that know a lot about this particular issue. As many of you know, the Housing Assistance Council has been working in rural communities for about 50 years, and we've tried to place a particular emphasis on what we would classify as high need or high poverty rural communities. And border colonial communities fit that definition. We've worked in an array of ways in those communities over the last 5 decades. We're really excited to be engaged in this particular project, and we're really looking forward to your feedback again because you know these communities, you're experts, you live there, you work there, and we really need your feedback for this input. Today's conversation is a little different than normal, I would say, than most webinars, and it's about definitions. And I know that's, not really sexy or might not be the kind of the top of the mind what we're talking about, but that's what we're talking about because it is extremely important. And what I would talk about it at the ultimate goal is kind of resource delivery, the efficient delivery of resources to communities. And before we do that, we need to kind of define something, particularly in this context. And that's where we're looking for your assistance today. You were targeted today because of your expertise in this area and in this geographic location. So just to get back, we're going to talk about definitions of colonias and what those mean. But oftentimes, if I can have a parallel, sometimes at HAC, we're asked about other definitions, how you define rural. And I used to say, it really doesn't matter. But I've changed my tune on that to the point that I think it does. It actually matters a lot, particularly around what we noted before, kind of resource allocation and the direction of resources in a particular community. And this particular area has had, its own challenges on how you define it and just basic lack of information and data in some of these areas. And so just to give you a little bit of background, I think many of you on the call know what colonies are. We're not going to go into detail about that, but they do often lack certain elements that many other communities have and also share other shared indices. But one of the other main constraints that they have is that we do lack some information and some clarity about what they are and where they are located. And just to give you just a geographic example, we'll probably show you a lot of maps today, but this illustration, the gray area, just shows you one of the more traditional definitions of what is a colonia community. And it's the most often referred to. It's the what we call the Cranston-Gonzalez definition of 150 miles north of the U.S.-Mexico border. That's a very been a long term. It's developed in 1990 or codified in 1990, and it's often used. And we're not saying that's better or worse. We're just saying for various technical programmatic reasons and also just kind of newer data reasons, we've been rethinking this concept, especially around the concept of mortgage delivery. And this just shows you that same line in Arizona. I wanted to make an important point about Arizona when we were doing this work around definitions. And again, we'll get to the point on what it really means on resource allocation. But we really wanted to focus on Arizona and each of the border colonia states. Oftentimes, I think people outside of the region think of this area as kind of monolithic. It's just the U.S.-Mexico border. But what we found in a lot of our work and a lot of our preliminary analysis is these definitions vary a lot by the state that they're in. There are just vast differences in the way colonias are defined and how they're structured and how they act in reality in the four different border states. So we really wanted to be purposeful and just meet with you in Arizona to get that information, quite frankly. And that's why we're focusing particularly on this state. We've already had a conversation with the folks in New Mexico, and we'll be following up with another conversation in Texas. But we're focusing particularly on that geography today. We did want to introduce an interactive poll question, and just to gauge where the audience is on this, and say, our question is, do you have trouble or confusion identifying or defining colonial communities for programs or resources? And if you could just kind of weigh in, yes, no, or don't know, and then vote. Okay, it looks like we've got a lot of people who have, at least those that are responding on the poll, have some issues around the definitions, which is, I think what we assumed, well, that might not be a large representative sample, but hopefully we can move forward there on that gives us a good baseline of where the audience may be or where we are in this particular element. So I will. Just also introduce, I'm going to talk about, we're going to do a couple of things here today. The first main element is just talk about what is a Colonias investment area and why are we thinking about this now, some of the technical components of that. And then we're going to have our chief researcher, our senior researcher, Keith Wiley, who's talked about what does that mean in practice and particularly how does it look in the state of Arizona. But the first is why are we looking at this definition now? And for various reasons, I think it's good to oftentimes, update and look at these areas, but quite frankly, there's some specific elements around the duty to serve, the new duty to serve for rural communities, which was a mandate for the Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac to actually have more mortgage activity and more liquidity, provide more mortgage activity, more ORGs access and liquidity in certain rural communities. And one of those was Colonia. Some of the other high need communities that were mandated in this law, they were much more well defined than this issue. So technically in the law, they are required to kind of help identify these. They didn't provide a list, unlike some of the other communities. So that is our intersection, that's HAC's intersection, to help define and understand these communities better, particularly for this resource around mortgage access. And to get to the crux of it really is at its very base. I'm going to go through the details. It quite frankly is just census tracts that have a colonia. And we'll get to the rationale about why we chose that methodology, but there are a couple of larger scale reasons for that. The first of which is it is actually just required in the regulation and some of that language is a technical requirement. But then there are less rigid, but other good reasons. And like any definition, there are pros and cons. But we think there are some good reasons around this, particularly along the dynamics of this is the lowest level of geography where you can also garner other data to help you assess what the definition is, but also more importantly, possibly the evaluative component, like what's happened there after you establish that. Other definitions in other areas of Colonia, you simply don't know. You don't have identifiable data at any meaningful scale that you can assess or analyze. So it's very important, and I think from that perspective. And then there are just other larger perspectives from the census tract, particularly related to this particular commodity of mortgage access and providing credit in mortgage credit in these communities. And that I think is a different commodity than some other areas of that are services that might be needed in the colonias. So that's we can talk about that. There's some technical requirements around that, but quite frankly, we think that's the most meaningful measure. And in many respects, I know this is not a technical term, but it's what I would call the Goldilocks. We're really striving for the Goldilocks approach here, where it's not too hot, not too cold, just right. Again, you never get it just right, but I think we're really striving towards that. But we want to hear your feedback. So just go over some very basic elements of how you define a colonial investment area, or how we're defining it. And there are really four primary elements. And it's called identification, location, aggregation, and compilation. Hopefully, we won't make this too technical. We'll run through this. There was a lot of work behind this, quite frankly. But this work is quite frankly, we're distilling it down into these large buckets, and hopefully making it understandable, even though there was a large or a vast amount of work that went into this to this construct. The first of which is identification, and the law basically states that you have to identify colonias from publicly recognized lists. So that we did. We consulted various lists, and they already have to be established, and they have to be publicly identified. But they don't have to be a federal source; they could be a municipality, as long as they're a publicly identified list. So we largely use some resources. We have others that we'll note in more detail. But for some examples, pre-existing lists from HUD, the USDA, and EPA, the various states have their own list, and there are local municipalities. And here is a more detailed list that Keith, our analyst, put together of some of the resources that we identified for the state of Arizona. And as we noted, Arizona was different. Some other states didn't have as many resources, some had more. But these are the actual resources, and you'll be able to see this when we archive. You'll be able to access these better when we archive the webinar. But with five or six kind of major resources that we use to identify the actual colonial communities. And this is just a numeric illustration of the number of colonia each of those sources identified. And then, as you noted, We identified in the sum in the aggregate about 118 colonia, and that's going through a process of triangulating and removing duplicates. So some of the lists had the same colonia twice or three or four times. But at the end of the day, after all that quality control and all that triangulation, we identified about 118 specific colonia in the state of Arizona. And this is just an example of what that list might look like. We just showed you the kind of the list of some of those and how we compiled it. The second major element of that after identification is location. And those might sound like the same thing, but they are distinctly different. So when we identify the list, sometimes it's purely just on a piece of paper, a list, and it'll say Chula Vista, and it might say in Arizona, but that's all the information we have. And that is a big difference between what we would call locating it physically on a map. Where is it actually located? And we did that through, so we used the list, and then we went through location processes through GIS software and mapping software using concepts of points and polygons and underlying geography. I don't want to get in a lot of those details, and Dr. Wiley, our researcher, can answer those better than me. But just to give you a quick example, the next stage was to move to identify them. The difference between a point and polygon, I'll go over this very quickly. You'll see these orange areas. You know they have a defined boundary. Those are actually colonia. That's what we call a polygon. It's when we know the boundaries of the actual geography. The point is there's another colonia located here, and it only has a point. So it's not just that point. We just know that's where the colonia is located. It's usually the center of it, but it doesn't have defined boundaries. And that's one of the challenges of working on this project, where you had some polygons and some points. Obviously, we'd rather have the polygons, but not in all instances would we have those. So kind of a unique circumstance and the challenge with these particular areas. The third element of this is aggregating to the larger level. So it's just aggregating up. And so we started with the colonia. We identified the specific colonia. Then we went up to census blocks. And then we aggregated the census tracts. And so aggregation just simply means if there was a colonia in a block, and then we went back up to the census tract to identify census tracts that had a colonia. It's a pretty simple process, a lot of work, quite frankly, to go into to do all of that, but that's what we did. And this is just a geographic illustration. So the orange areas there are in Arizona. You'll see those are the colonia that we identified. But then we move to the next stage where we identified the census tract. So those are the lighter orange areas that have colonia community, quite frankly. Those are the lighter orange areas. So in essence, we identified all those tracts that contained a colonia community. And then the final stage was just to pull the colonia back out and just say, these are the colonia investment areas. Quite simply, a colonia community, a tract that had a colonia community in it. And at the end of the day, this is the primary concept, a colonia investment area. And then finally, compilation. This is where we did a lot of data quality. We actually add additional data, give it value added data, but ultimately we also need to, even though they're different states, we needed to, for this process and for the regulation and to help Fannie Mae, to compile them across all four states. So we take these disparate data sets and then we compile one large master database with all those uniquenesses in them, make them uniform and add some value added data for better analysis. But those are the four major steps. And ultimately, at the end of this process, for the state of Arizona, we identified about 94 what we would call colonia investment tracts, or colonia investment areas, which are census tracts that have a colonia. And you'll notice those make up about 6.6% of the population in the border area of Arizona. And then finally, this is just another geographic illustration of those areas. And the darker the shade of the colonia investment areas, any of those that are identified here or highlighted in the state of Arizona are a colonia investment area, but the darker the shade indicates there are more colonia in those communities. This is more of a density measure to show you the darker orange areas or the brighter orange areas actually have more colonia. Just yet another measure. That's a good segue into the presentation, the second part of the presentation, where our chief analyst, our data analyst, Dr. Keith Wiley, basically used this construct and helped analyze what those markets look like, particularly in Arizona. So at this point, I'm going to kind of turn it over to to Keith to get his assessment. So thank you, Keith. Maybe you can provide your some of your research and analysis to better inform this issue. Thanks.
Yes, thanks, Lance. Yes, thanks everybody for being here. And yeah, I'm going to go through a little bit of a little preliminary analysis we've done. Then once we've identified those Colonia investment areas, we wanted to look at some of the data to see what they look like. And first, what I did was we did some literature review and we found some of the key measures so to get a description. And we looked at this in the aggregate. And what we you can see what we looked at here. For that, we wanted to look at the demographic variables, and what we did was this might look a little confusing at first. Sorry, I put a lot on here, but what it is if you notice the blue bar is for the U.S., and then the lightest orange bar is for the state of Arizona, the next darkest orange bar is for the border region, and the top brightest orange bar is for the Colonia area. So we looked at certain measures, and like the one is the rural population, the duty to serve rural. So about 23% of the U.S. population is duty to serve rural, but about 51% of the Colonia investment area would qualify for that or rural. So it shows you they're more rural, and that's kind of what we would expect. If you then the state, which is 14.8, and the entire border region in Arizona, which is only 8.4, but that's a bit misleading because the border region in Arizona includes Phoenix and Tucson primarily. So, but it shows that the Colonias are more often than not in rural tracts. I think of those 94 tracts that Lance mentioned, about 54 of them were rural. And it's got a relatively high Hispanic or Latino population. For the state, it's about 31%, but for the Colonia investment areas, it's about 39%. We also wanted to look at the younger population under age 18, and we see about 25%, 24.6% of the population in Colonia investment areas under age 18 compared to 24% basically for the state and 23% for the U.S., so it's a little bit younger. And there's a higher poverty rate at 19.6% compared to 17.7% for the state and 15% for the U.S. And these are kind of characteristics that reading the literature, you think you might find it a slightly more rural population, well, considerably more rural, a larger Hispanic population, a younger population, and more poverty. And next, we looked at some housing characteristics. And again, just to get an understanding and a kind of a feel for what these tracts, the population and the characteristics there. And it's a similar approach. The blue is the U.S. The lightest orange is Arizona. The next darkest orange is the Arizona border region, U.S.-Mexico border region. And then the darkest or the brightest orange is the Colonia investment areas. And you can see there's a high owner occupancy rate, owner occupied unit rate in the Colonias. It's 71% compared to 63.6 for the U.S. and 62.6 for the state of Arizona. And that again makes some sense. You know, we know that it's largely rural. There's a higher owner occupied unit rate there anyway. And then also a point here is that, you know, even the owner occupied units would also capture housing units, even if somebody had like an unfair contract for deed or something, it still would be classified as owner occupied. And another point here that the manufactured home units, and, you know, I should have suspected this, it's similar to New Mexico. About 22% of the units in the Colonia investment area were manufactured homes, and that's really high compared to 5.7 for the U.S. and 8.9 for the state. And that's really, really high, and that's similar to New Mexico. And a lot of that's probably going to reflect the geography and probably the cost of providing housing. Many of these rural tracts are, you know, it might be very, very expensive to build a house in, and that, you know, would contribute to making a manufactured home much more a low-cost option here. And I'll talk about it in a little bit when we look at the mortgage loan data, but that's an important factor, the manufactured homes, the high share of them being there. We look at homes less than $10,000. We find out it's about 3.5% for the Colonia investment tracts, compared to about 2.8 for the state and 2 for the U.S., so it's a bit higher. We might expect that. And then the plumbing at 0.8% of the units without plumbing compared to 0.7 for the state and 0.4 for the U.S. And I'd point out that the plumbing and the housing values, in some of the literature, there's some discussion that the estimates might be an underestimate to begin with, you know, because it might be missing some of the people in these areas. But it is higher than the national rate, which does, you know, kind of support what you might think. These tracts have more homes that are of lower value and lack plumbing. So it kind of gives you an interesting picture and very similar to what you might expect, and actually similar to New Mexico in some ways. Now, one of the areas that I really like to work on is Home Mortgage Disclosure Act data, or HMDA. And here we look at it between 2015 and 2017. And I do an annual average. And I just want to look at the kind of lending that's going on here, because after all, the duty to serve is supposed to increase liquidity here. And HMDA is a really good source, a resource, and allows you to get a better understanding of just what's going on in this market. These markets, and that'll, you know, I think really be important to understand that in order to help and increase liquidity, get a better understanding of just what is happening there. And so I really am trying, this is analysis that's going on right now, just trying to compare activities inside and outside of the Colonia Investment Area, just to kind of get a feel. And what I really want to do is try to find areas that stand out in particular about the market and the loans that are going on or aren't occurring there. And we're going to look primarily at the amount of lending, just the borrower characteristics and loan type. And it's an aggregate. Later on, I'd like to look at individual Colonia Investment Area tracts. But and this is also another part, if anybody has any comments or any thoughts, I'd really appreciate it, because a lot of times you see it in the data, but you don't truly appreciate it until somebody says, oh, well, this is what's really going on there. So one of the things we did was just a really kind of a crude or a rough measure. I like this figure a lot. I think it looks pretty interesting. But what we did was I standardized it, and I said the annual number of loans per owner-occupied units, just to see about the amount of lending volume that would be occurring there. And you would expect it to be limited. And so what this figure tells you is the blue bar is the U.S., and then it goes Arizona, Arizona border region, Colonias, and then I pull out rural in this case to highlight it. But you can see it says there's about 100.8 or 101 loans per 1,000 owner-occupied units in the U.S. annually during this period. And for Arizona and Arizona border region, it went up to 139.9 or 140, and then 145. And that makes some sense, because this is a growing region that there might be more activity there. But then you go to the Colonia Investment Area, the kind of the reddish orange bar, it goes down to 94.3 loans per 1,000 owner-occupied units. And then if you go to the rural Colonia Investment Area, it goes clear down to 56.4. So it's much less activity. And I know what you might be thinking, and there is some of this that, well, it's rural, you know, and I grew up in a rural area, and there oftentimes aren't a lot of loans going on there. And so maybe this is primarily reflecting just rural, and it's not a Colonia issue or related to the Colonia investment area. So what we did was I tried to separate it out to get a better look at it. And this figure might be a little weird, but I can explain it here. The blue cubes are for the areas that are not in the Colonia investment area, the number of loans per 1,000 occupied units, and the triangles are for the ones that are. And so first I just said within the border region, the parts that aren't in the Colonia Investment Area had about 148 loans per 1,000 owner-occupied units, compared to 94 for the ones that were in the Colonia Investment Area. So there's a clear difference there just in the border region, but it still could be rural maybe. So then I pulled out just the rural tracts in that border region. And so the ones that weren't in a Colonia Investment Area, there was 116 loans per 1,000 owner-occupied units. But the ones that were in a Colonia Investment Area, it was just 56.4, so on the other slide. So there is a difference. It appears to be there's a considerable difference there in the amount of activity. And again, you would kind of expect this, but I think that's really interesting. Even if you're just looking at rural parts of the border region, whether it's in a Colonia Investment Area or it's not, there's much less activity going on there. And, you know, that could be reflecting that it's, as in the literature would say, that it's difficult getting financing in Colonia communities. And it could also partially reflect the fact that these communities may be in areas that are kind of more isolated and there's less activity. But it's really interesting, and I think bears more a closer scrutiny and kind of confirms what you might think. And so the next area I wanted to look at was Hispanic or Latino lending, because they make up a sizable part, almost 40% or so of the population in the Colonia Investment Area. And so what I did here was, this is kind of a rough measure. I broke it up by geography, Arizona border region, the Colonia Investment Area, and the Colonia Investment Area rural. And what I did was I took for the light blue is the percent of owner-occupied units that were Hispanic or Latino, essentially their share of the owner-occupied housing stock in the geography. And then for the orange bar, that's their share of the originations annually. So in other words, what's their share of the units that are owner-occupied, and what's their share of the mortgage lending in those areas? And you see for the state, what this says is about 18% of the owner-occupied units were occupied by Hispanic or Latino household, and about 17% of the loans were. So there's a little difference. And you see it grows a little bit in the border region, 19.4% of the owner-occupied units Hispanic or Latino, and 18% of the loans. And then you go to the investment areas, it's 28.1% of the occupied housing stock or Hispanic Latino compared to 25. And then the difference gets most pronounced in rural, about 30% of the owner-occupied units and about 25% of the loans. And I think this underestimates, really, I actually think if you think about it, the orange bar should be higher than the light blue bar, because they're, if you're a growing share of the population and you're a growing share of the owner-occupied units, which they are in many of these areas, that they should have a higher share of the lending volume. So the difference is even more pronounced, I think. But it just shows that relative to their share of the owner-occupied units, particularly in the colonias, they're getting less of the lending volume. And again, I think it's a little bit more pronounced because it should be higher. Instead of like being 29.7 and 25 for the rural Colonia Investment Areas, the orange bar should probably be like 30 couple, I would think. Now, another part that we talked about, and this keeps coming up, and again, we deal with a lot in rural areas, but manufactured housing is, as we saw in the couple slides back, is really common in the area. There's a high share of it in the Colonia Investment Areas. And so what we did here was I broke it down, United States, Arizona, the Arizona border region, and then the Colonia Investment Areas. And the blue bar is the total for the area, and the orange bar is for the rural part. And so one of the reasons why I put them like this is, first of all, it might seem obvious, but what this says is 1.8% of the originations annually in the United States involved a manufactured home. But for the rural parts, it was 6.3%. And so you constantly see that difference, first of all, and that makes perfect sense, right? There's way more manufactured home loans in rural areas. You don't normally see them in urban or suburban areas. So that's a constant difference. But if you look as it goes on, by the time you get to the Colonia Investment Areas, they make up 7.6% of all the loans, and about 17.3% of the loans annually that occurred there on the rural part. So that's a lot, right? And I'll talk about it here in a second, but manufactured home loans are often high cost loans. So this kind of has, repercussions later on when you're looking at the data. And it's also part of the duty to serve, another part of the requirements. I'm not actually an expert in that, but there's a manufactured housing element as well, but it's a large amount of the loans. And this is very similar for New Mexico, actually. And again, it makes some sense, right? Because if it's very expensive to build a home here, and these are very kind of sparsely populated places, this may be one of the only really available low-income options that could be available to people. And what I did last time, and I thought is really interesting to show, is I went back to the ACS data and I plotted it by county. And all that I wanted to show was the darkest blue is where there a quarter or more of the homes are manufactured homes. And the shade below that's 15 to 25. And so the purple or pink line on here would be the 150 mile point. And this is by county, but you can see over near Yuma to the west side of Phoenix is blue, and then even below it is a little lighter shade, but it's 15 to 25. And then over near Graham and like Greenlee County and a little bit east of Tucson is, and that's largely, I think, driving it. That means one out of every four occupied units in three of those counties is a manufactured home, and essentially one in five in the other couple counties. And if you'll notice, what you would expect for Phoenix and that is very low proportion. But these are kind of driving it, and you can kind of see the same thing in a New Mexico data. If you look at it by county, you can see the areas of concentration, and that's being reflected in the Colonia number. And again, I think that's very interesting because it adds another dimension to this issue. And what that oftentimes ends up having, it has an impact on high cost loans. And so I put this slide in here, and it shows it's very similar. The light blue is for the total, and the orange is for the rural part of the duty to serve. And again, I have United States, Arizona border region, and in the Colonia investment areas. And you'll notice the difference in high cost loans in rural exists everywhere. Although it's a little bit for Arizona in the border region, it's a little smaller. And I'm not fully sure about that, why that is, but you can see like 5.9% of all the loans in the U.S. were high cost, but 8.9% of the duty to serve rural loans were. And part of that's related to the manufactured housing. Not fully, but about 60% of all loans involving a manufactured home are high cost. So they drive a lot of that difference. And then when you get out here to the far right, or the Arizona Colonia investment area, the highest is 13% of the loans in investment areas and duty to serve rural are high cost. And a large part of that would be manufactured homes. And what that means, a high cost loan, is it's a certain amount of interest above a prime rate loan or a similar prime rate loan. And why that occurs with manufactured homes is they're treated like a car loan as opposed to a mortgage loan. And that's not the full, if you looked at single family, there would be a difference as well, but it's just more pronounced with the manufactured homes. And what that says is, it just in general in the Colonia investment area, about 10% of all loans are high cost. So, and that means that they're paying extra money and interest for their mortgage loans. And one other area that I'm, and again, this is preliminary, and I welcome all comments or thoughts on this, that we're looking at are loan types. And HMDA labels loans basically to whether they're conventional or they're FHA, USDA, or VA loans. And so all that I did was I just took them all over this three-year period and just essentially put them into proportions and the shares. And then the bottom is the U.S. The next line above is Arizona. The next line is Arizona border region. And the next line is the Arizona Colonia investment areas. And if you'll notice here, about 73% of the U.S. loans over this three-year period were conventional loans. And it's a good bit higher than for Arizona or the border region or the Colonia, which is in between, you know, 62 and 58%. So that means there was a larger share of the total lending activity that occurred in the country was conventional loans than occurred in the state or in the region. And that essentially means there was more government like the FHA loan, guaranteed loans and stuff in that area. I'm not exactly sure why that proportion would be that way for the entire state. I would think in the Colonia investment areas, due to the fact that there's much more limited activity there, the larger share of government supported loans may reflect the fact that there's just not a lot of lending activity that occurs there, right? And so therefore it might not be that there's a lot of, say, FHA loans. It might be that there's essentially a dearth of conventional lending there. And one other thing that I find here that I'm really interested in and maybe getting some thoughts on would be that the VA loans, and this I found this in New Mexico as well, the proportion of VA loans here increased steadily. It's 9.1% of the lending volume during this period in the U.S. It goes up to 15.6% for Arizona, up to 18.8% of the loans on the border region, and up to 19% for these Colonia investment area tracts. And I'm not completely sure why that is. I mean, some of it makes some sense. There's a relatively high veteran population in the state, and there are also several big kind of like military installations, like the Yuma Proving Ground is in this area. The Barry Goldwater, I think like a missile range is in this area. So maybe that is in fact driving a lot of it. But I just thought it was really interesting. That means about one out of every five loans during this period was a VA loan, which is kind of high. And so That was just one thing I found very interesting in the distribution of activity. And it would be really interesting to see, and I'm working on it right now, breaking that down by rural and urban Colonia Investment Area to get an understanding or a better feel for why that is. But those are the kind of things I find very interesting, like what is the volume of loans going on there? What type of loans are they? Are they being directly immediately sold and maybe purchased by a GSE? Are they being held on to? Those kind of issues I hope to get into, and I hope to broaden this out a little bit by looking at it by census tract. And I do again want to point out that if you have any thoughts or ideas, because we talked about this with some other people, and you know there may be other lending going on that's not even not included in HMDA, which would be interesting to, you know, just because maybe there's a dearth of activity reported to HMDA doesn't mean there's not lending going on here, right? And maybe there is some other markets or something else going on. It'd be interesting to note or document or something like that, you know, to better understand access and liquidity in these areas. It might not just be reported in HMDA. It might be, you know, other kind of loan market. And we got a closing up question here. Anissa, just hoping to get a feel for what you think of our approach here, because we're really trying to, like Lance said, we're trying to get a fine line here between, you know, not too hot, not too cold. But do you think that Colonia Investment Areas adequately capture the locations where Colonia exists in Arizona? Because what we're really looking for is that we want to make sure that these reflect it. We're trying to improve upon, like, the 150 miles, and that's just it, because we want these to be, you know, targeted and effective, lifting people and lifting communities up and improving their housing conditions. So we're just seeking advice and thoughts that you have to make sure that we're adequately, in this research, adequately reflects those communities. So I'll just, wait here just a second and, you know, but, because you never know. A lot of times I do data and I don't actually get to these communities and you know them. And so you would have thoughts or, you know, ideas that would be important that I may not think about. Okay, well, it seems that most do, and well, thank you, and I appreciate that. And again, if anybody has any thoughts, I would really, you know, be interested in hearing them. Again, it's a challenge to do it, and to get it just right. And by very nature of Colonia communities, you know, they're kind of tough to find sometimes and define. So there may be some element you might miss, and we wouldn't want to do that. And just to conclude, most of the people actually live within the border region in Arizona, because Phoenix and Tucson is there. And by the border region, I mean within 150 miles, which I think is very interesting. Of all the states, it's the only one where that is the case. And so it is an important matter there. There's 118 Colonia there. We were able to locate like 110 of them. And so it's not rare. I think a lot of times people think they just exist in Texas, and that's actually not true. And so it is an important issue. They have the third most there, and they're really close, similar to New Mexico in total. These areas are often rural, and that's not always the case in places like Texas and Hidalgo County. They aren't necessarily. They have a relatively large Hispanic or Latino population, which is, like Lance said, they're always different from state. That's not necessarily the case in California. There's lots of manufactured homes here, which I think is very interesting and adds a whole other dimension to this. It maybe gets into maybe the duty to serve manufacturing home element. And there's appears to be, at least just in looking at the investment areas, there's limited activity, particularly in the rural census tracts or Colonia Investment Areas. There's a lot less activity. It needs more scrutiny, of course, but I think that's important, and likely the manufactured home lending shapes a lot of it. And it'll be interesting maybe to look at the age of the manufactured home stock there as well, to see what kind of You know, if it's older units, you know, that may also raise some other questions about rehabilitation or livability. I think there still needs to be, you know, probably more information. As Lance was saying, a lot of these we had to use points as opposed to boundaries, which is very difficult, you know, and more information is always better. And also a better understanding of them. It's a very diverse place, and there's like some on tribal lands and whatnot. There's different places. So more information is always better. But I think duty to serve can help with this. And the reason why is because this issue had largely, at least from my literature review, it largely fallen off the radar before 2000, up to 2005, and then it was kind of not an issue until recently with the duty to serve and some of the USDA EPA studies. You know, it was a big issue around the time of NAFTA, and particularly then in up through the 90s with efforts by HUD and other agencies. And then somewhere about the mid-2000s, like even the USGS's effort to put an online mapping tool to find the communities, kind of, it's not there anymore. And so I don't know, it maybe became a victim of the financial crisis and other issues kind of overtook it. But I think duty to serve can do a lot to put it back on the agenda, right? This requirement, and then, you know, place closer scrutiny. In some ways, the regulation by saying it's open, they want people to find out and improve upon it. Sometimes that's a better approach. And if nothing else, that stuff like the duty to serve will call attention and we'll get a better understanding of it. And then we can build back on what was done before. So I think there's a lot of potential here. And I think the duty to serve can add a lot to it. So with that, I guess I'll close and turn it back over.
Thank you, Keith. This is Lance. I would, at this point, I think we really would like to turn it over back to you guys, because I think that's the crux of this. I would like to thank Dr. Wiley and his team. He's showing you that's a lot of work in a relatively condensed kind of format. There was a lot of work that went into that, and it wasn't easy work. So I'd like to thank them for all their analysis. But the real reason that we're having you guys, we want to present this issue to you, is to kind of get your feedback. Does this comport with your findings or your understanding of those communities, to get better get feedback? So we really just wanted to open it up for comments or questions and see if you had any input or feedback to help us to improve this concept or advance it. So I think I'll open up at this point, Shantaria.
All right, I will jump in, but I will ask that whoever has their local line live, if you could please mute that line so that we can avoid the feedback. We have a few questions that have come in over the Q&A box, and I think if there is whoever that is with their mic open, could you please mute that line? All right, so the first question to clarify, does the Colonia Investment Area concept you've described cast a wider net or a more narrow net as compared to the current definition for what areas are considered colonias?
Ours is we're trying to get generally more precise. Yes, we're trying to generally most of the time it's just solely based, I think, in general, on distance. And we're trying to identify those areas that are more specific, to be more like, as opposed to county, we're trying to get down to the census tract level. And that's and I think that it should be more precise, but as I think Lance did a good job of reiterating, and he might want to say comment on this, you want to be precise but not too precise. And they even say that in the duty to serve regulation about, you know, you don't want to be too precise because it may restrict efforts. But we're more precise with the areas we define as being where colonias are than oftentimes it's just a simple distance thing.
Well, but my mom's brother.
Before we move on, if there is someone out there with an open mic, could we please close that or mute your line?
So she upset. You need to go home and offer whatever comfort and assistance you need.
Okay, so we are going to move on to the next question that we have. And the next question says, are any of the Colonias communities on tribal land?
Don't worry about us right now. Let's Zach know that you have.
Yes, and this is an interesting thing that I would like to, I think is really interesting with Arizona. There are multiple, like six or seven tribes that actually have colonias on their land. The Salt River, the Gila River, and this is really interesting because how they might be different, you know, than other colonias. And there's actually a rather large Native American population in the Colonia region, and particularly the rural part of it. It's over like 10%, and that's really interesting. I think that adds another dimension than, you know, on tribal lands, and there's not as much information out there on them. So, and that would also probably dovetail with the duty to serve Native American lands requirement as well. But there are definitely there's like seven tribes where there's a colonia on tribal land in Arizona, which is pretty unique. I don't think there are any in Texas, and I think there are in California, maybe one or two, but that's really a fascinating element, I think. And the data is not quite as rich maybe as you'd want, but I'm fascinated to see what it looks like, the lending volume.
If you're going to leave tomorrow or whatever, then you can give Zach your password and put in the
Let's see, there's a comment that has come in from Martha. Martha wants to know, how can local governments engage Fannie Mae, whose updated plan to encourage more lending in the colonias such as Ajo and South Tucson, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Hi, this Terry, this is Lance.
Could you please repeat the question?
The question is, how can local government engage Fannie Mae to encourage more lending in the colonias?
Thanks for the question. This is Sam Lipschutz from Fannie Mae. I think the best course of action would be we would love to talk with you, actually. So maybe Shantaria can connect us after the call, and we can talk more about that, about your specific situation and ideas, and we would love to be in touch.
Thank you, Sam. The next question is, what is the one thing that is most missing from the data, or the one area where more information is needed?
I would say, in just a general sense, would be the location data. And Arizona is unique. In Texas, that's mainly boundaries, shape files, where you have actual boundaries. But in Arizona, about two-thirds of this is based on points. We're really lucky to have them, actually, because there's not as much information. So more location information would probably be would be very helpful to get a better grasp at the location of these. I mean, we have the point, but boundary data would be really, really useful. And then about the Native American lands would be interesting as well too. The tribal lands, maybe a bit more information, because there might be unique things there that would be interesting to understand, that maybe help better serve that market. And one other thing that I didn't touch on here that is important is related to this, is that I mentioned it a little bit, is that this is a growing area. So that's another element that's pretty unique. The population growth rate here is pretty high. So that's another element that I haven't studied yet, but not, you know, would be, but that's on my, for me to do. But I would say definitely more location information, in general, and then maybe more information about the communities on tribal lands.
Thanks, Shantaria. This is Lance, and I would only add to that, I don't disagree with any of what Keith said, but, and I know I sound like a broken record here, but what we really need is you, and I know that sounds hokey, but the data really can only get us so far, as valuable as it is. We need people on the ground, and we were going to open this up. Hopefully, feel free to contact us, but we need your perspective, quite frankly. That's as invaluable as almost any of the data, right, to help us move that further. So we want your insights and your expertise and how you perceive this, quite frankly. I think that's the one thing that's missing here, and that's why we're coming to you. We appreciate your feedback. We're going to keep this open. We're going to have an iterative discussion. We're going to have a few more of these discussions, but please feel free to contact us in any manner to give us your impressions or your thoughts or your suggestions. So that would be my answer to the question.
You're absolutely right, Lance. No, you are. One phone call with some information is probably going to make a makes huge difference.
And we've received some good feedback from prior conversations that we've had in both Texas and New Mexico. So we hope that we get some of that feedback from Arizona, because as we noted, these are very different by state. At least that's what the initial data are telling us. And you are the experts here. As knowledgeable as Keith and our research team is on this, we are sitting behind computers. We've been aided by our Southwest office, and we get a lot of assistance from our partners in the field. But really, the data can only take us so far. So thank you.
Yes.
All right. With that being said, Lance will have the last word of the day. We are at the top of the hour. I'd like to thank Kelly, Sam, Lance, and Keith for the information that's been shared today, as well as for each of you for your time and your patience as we work through our technical glitch at the start of the webinar. We'll ask that you take a brief moment to quickly fill out the participation survey that you'll receive by email. That is the way that HAC is able to know if we're bringing the most relevant content to you based on your programs and services. So thank you all again for joining us today, and enjoy the rest of your afternoon. Goodbye.